Greetings, programs. My name is Rich, and I'd like to welcome you to my review of Batman v Superman Dawn of Justice. Now, this is a movie that has had just a little bit of hype, not a whole lot. You probably haven't even noticed it. And I went and saw it last night during the premiere, and I wanted to give my thoughts on it. And I thought, what better way to do that than by playing some Injustice Gods Among Us? Because this is probably ever, and it's got both Batman and Superman in it. So, when saw it, to tell you guys the gods... Oh, actually, probably now would be a good time to give some disclaimers first. The first disclaimer is I do not classify myself as a fanboy. What I mean by that is I am not overly pro-DC or overly pro-Marvel. I like comic books, and I like comic book characters, and I like comic book work. I don't really have any allegiance to one company or the other. I take what I want and leave the rest. If you put a gun to my head and told me you can only read one comic brand for the rest of your life and you can't even look at the others, what would it be? Without even really blinking, I'd probably say Dark Horse, which dates me by quite a bit. But that's pretty much how I feel on the matter. Now, this movie, I was really nervous when I went to go see it because I had heard that the film had received a 38% rotten rating on RottenTomatoes.com, and that did give me a bit of pause, I'm not gonna lie. But going to see it, and it is a long movie, it's about 2 hours and 30 minutes long. Also, speaking of disclaimers, lots of spoiler talk, so if you don't want the movie spoiled, I would go ahead and stop this video now and watch this until after you've seen the movie. But 2 hours and 40 minutes long, and after watching it, I can honestly tell you that the movie was decent. It was good. On a ranking of 1 to 5 stars, I'd give it about 3.5. And on a 1 through 10 ranking, I would give it a solid 7. It was I was actually expecting far worse. I thought that it got hyped way too much, and I thought that that overhype was going to ruin it. And it did a little bit, but I don't think the hype was the thing that ruined it. I think it was the fact that the trailers showed way, way more of the movie than it should have. There were some scenes during that second trailer that revealed Doomsday that just completely gave away the plot to the film, because no one knew. Everyone thought, okay, Batman and Superman are going to fight. And then during that second trailer, you saw Doomsday and Wonder Woman, and you kind of already knew what was about to happen. Batman and Superman are going to fight, Doomsday shows up, Wonder Woman shows up to even the odds, and the big three unite. Now, I will go ahead and talk about characters first, and then I'll talk about story. Now, there's going to be a lot of rambling here, so just bear with me. But we'll go ahead and start with Superman, Henry Cavill, who I have to say is probably my second favorite Superman besides Christopher Reeve. Christopher Reeve is always going to be my Superman. That's who I grew up with. That's who I loved. So he's always going to be number one. But I have to say that Cavill, I really like what he's done with the character. Ooh, hi Scarecrow. I've been a big fan. And he, through his facial expressions and how he talks and such, he's done a great job with the character. But I don't think people had seen him in Man of Steel. And anything that's wrong with Man of Steel, I think that's probably a really key point, that any problems people have seemed to have with these DC movies, at least with Man of Steel and this film, has nothing to do with the actors, really. It's just how everything was presented. And let's go with Triangle. Cavill's an awesome Superman. Now, a lot of people really wanted to see what exactly was going to happen with Ben Affleck playing Superman. And a lot of people were nervous about it because, well, it's Ben Affleck who has this kind of tendency to... You can't really not see Ben Affleck in a role. You always see Ben Affleck. You don't see the characters that he plays. But I have to say that I really liked Ben Affleck as Batman and Bruce Wayne. I thought he did a great job playing an older version of the character. And this may seem sacrilegious to some folks, but I actually liked him better than Christian Bale. I think he played Bruce Wayne very suave, very calm, very cynical, and his Batman is scary in terms of how big he is and how he can fight. And we'll get to the fight scenes here in a bit during this, but oh, there's Wonder Woman getting the lasso. But I think he certainly was good. I liked him a lot. I'm surprised that I liked it so much. I actually cannot wait to see a solo Batman movie because I think it's going to be really good. And apparently he's also going to be directing it, and Ben Affleck is an Academy Award-winning director. So that should be very, very interesting to see what happens. Now let's go ahead and talk about Wonder Woman, played by Gal Gadot. And I was disappointed with it, to tell you the truth. Gal Gadot has the facial structure and the vocals and whatnot to play Diana Prince the way I had always thought that she would be. But her build and whatnot is very... I'm not really a fan of that. And that's just a personal preference. It's no... You know... It just is what it is. And we actually did not get to see her fight at all. But you're like, Wretch, they fought in the trailer. You see her fighting. You see CGI fighting. You don't actually see her fighting. And it continues over the course of the movie that you don't really see Wonder Woman fight. You see her CGI fight, and then it shots to a picture of her reacting to what just happened. Like she getting knocked back or anything. You actually don't see Gal Gadot fight. Now, hopefully that'll change in the Wonder Woman movie, but it was kind of a letdown in terms of how the character was presented, because you know absolutely nothing about her. Batman and Superman, they don't even ask her where she comes from. There's no exposition about it at all. It's just, okay, well, she's a metahuman. She helped out. Good. That's fair enough. Moving on. For a movie that was so long and had so much that it needed to express, it some stuff they left basically kind of bare. And the one thing, the biggest issue I've seen a lot of people have with the movie is it... Oh, I thought I had grabbed Slade there. Nope, he is owning my face. It's the fact that they are trying to do way too much in 2.5 hours time. They're essentially... You remember how the Marvel movies, it took multiple movies before Avengers even popped up? They're trying to do all of the stuff that established Avengers in one movie. And I don't think it worked out the way that they really ideally wanted it to. Now, we move on to Lex Luthor. This was another thing I was very concerned about because it was a, The concept of Jesse Eisenberg, I think his name is, playing Lex Luthor was interesting because they were basically going to have him come off like he was the Mark Zuckerberg, that he was one of those internet... eclectic internet billionaires, and it was interesting because they were able to keep the basis of the Lex Luthor character, and they did. And let's go ahead and see if we can finish Deathstroke off here. There we are. It was a completely different take on the character from what I had seen. You'd seen him be a comedic evil in the Richard Donner Superman movies. You had seen him be a little bit more serious in Bryan Singer's Superman Returns. And you saw a complicated version of the character with multi-facets in Smallville, and of course the animated version that you've seen in the DC animated films, who is cerebral and more what a lot of people want Lex Luthor to be. This Lex Luthor was evil, but he came off as more of a mad scientist. And I thought I was going to hate, speaking of Lex Luthor, I thought I was going to hate how he was portrayed. I actually thought he was fine because this version of Lex Luthor is so the polar opposite of Superman that I kind of bought it. Very similar to how Joker and Batman are very different. It helped the dynamic out a lot. And despite the fact that he does not look like Lex Luthor, by the end of the movie, when he gets his head shaved, you're like, all right, you could see this. It could have been a lot worse, essentially. Who else? You had your typical support staff. You had Lois and Perry White and Martha Kent. They were just kind of there. Let's talk about Doomsday. Now, when Doomsday showed up in the trailer, a lot of people were upset, not only because they showed that aspect of the character, or that the character was going to be in the movie, but also, like, that doesn't look like Doomsday. And to tell you the truth, during the majority of the fight at the end, he does not look like Doomsday, but he starts slowly looking like the Doomsday that we know and love, because every single time he'd get, like, injured really badly, more spikes would shoot up, and that's what I figured was going to happen. But I didn't mind it. It kind of went for the opposite of what I've seen from Zack Snyder, because you saw Dr. Manhattan and his blue endowment, and this Superman, or this version of Doomsday, was quite the eunuch. But the thing that I really liked about, because I was like, oh, they're showing Doomsday right off the bat, and he's gonna job out to the big three, and what a waste, because I think that is a character that has been completely misused in comics after his debut. And I was glad to say that he does exactly what he does, or what he's done in the comics. He kills Superman. He puts one of those bone spurs right through Superman's heart, and Superman has the kryptonite spear, and he runs it through Doomsday's torso, and they simo each other. Now, of course, Superman's going to come back. But not only did Doomsday technically kill Superman, he fought the entire Big Three and held his own. So I'm okay with that. It could have been a lot worse. And that's probably the theme for this entire film, is it could have been a lot worse. What else? Oh, they've teased Darkseid. They didn't actually show him, like Avengers, when they kind of pull off Thanos. There's no scene at the end of the credits, by the way, which I was kind of disappointed with. But it's okay. Let's go ahead and just spam uppercut. Some people who watch fighting games hate when you spam uppercut. But I'm trying to think if there was anything else interesting. Like, there's... Oh, yes! I really liked Jeremy Irons as Alfred, just as the old, tired, techie Alfred. It was an interesting way of doing the character in a way that I hadn't seen before. So, I'm about to get hit with things. With some spy satellites. This movie, I really think, would have been a whole lot better had they split it into two parts. Or just done a Batman v Superman movie, and then done Dawn of Justice, because they do establish the other members of the Justice League. I think all of them except for perhaps Green Lantern. I don't know if Green Lantern would be in the Justice League movie. He should be. But they established Aquaman and Cyborg and the Flash, which was very interesting to see the interpretations of those characters. We had seen Aquaman before, but didn't expect to see Cyborg and the Flash. I'm very, very curious about the Flash movie now. So, and that was like a minute long scene where they're just establishing, okay, here are all these metahumans. We've got to gather them because Superman's dead. And Batman has found out via a conversation with Luthor that I guess when he, and they don't really establish that, but I think when Luthor went inside the Kryptonian scout ship and was talking to the computer, he must have contacted Apocalypse and let Darkseid know everything that was going on. It was a little bit bizarre how that came about, but... Oh, who are we fighting? Oh, we're fighting New 52. We're fighting Blackest Night Flash. And it's like, in terms of, like, plot holes, which I think was the biggest issue, was just little things, and I try not to be overly critical of movies, but this was just something that I could not see. Like, when Batman and Superman meet for the first time, Batman has the Batmobile, which was, excuse me, an excellent version of the vehicle, by the way. And he is he's chasing down these guys who you find out later work for Luthor. And he's in the Batmobile, and then Superman just shows up, and Batman runs into Superman. The Batmobile's very seriously damaged, and they have their little talk where Batman's like, Superman's like, you're done. If that signal goes off again, you don't answer it. Consider it a mercy. And my entire thing is, why... Oh, nice hit there, Flash. Why didn't Superman try and stop the van? Because the van had a guy shooting missiles. It wasn't just a one-sided thing where Batman was chasing these poor, innocent bystanders. And Superman should have, on his way in, due to the fact that he tracked down the Batmobile, saw what was about to happen. Man, Flash is eating my lunch. What was the deal there? He just left that van alone that was shooting out rockets and gunfire just so he could talk to Batman? That's... The priorities were kind of skewed there, I thought. Now, I think we can... There we go. And Flash is down. And there's also the aspect of, was the vision that Batman had about the Omega sign, which is obviously Darkseid's sign, among the ruins of the city, and then the boom tube opening up, and what I assume is Flash saying it's the key is Lois. It's kind of going into a similar storyline as we've seen here in Injustice, with Lois dying and Batman just losing his mind, because that's the world to him. So, I don't know. Like I said, I enjoyed it. It's a fun popcorn movie. I'll tell you the truth, though. The fights... Zack Snyder has been doing this thing, and it's been after Watchmen, because Watchmen is actually a dark, yet at the same time very colorful comic book movie. This is where the game's going to start beating me down. I have not played this game in ages, so I am very, very rusty and just kind of spamming buttons to see what works. But... ever since Man of Steel, he's been going for this kind of dark, grainy style, which I completely understand in terms of Batman. But Superman, and anyone who's seen Man of Steel knows how kind of color-saturated that film is. But they went for the dark aspect in the film, and I don't know if that would necessarily work. One thing I can tell you is I think Zack Snyder is extremely good at making close quarters, intimate fight scenes awesome. Because you have the fight with the big three versus Doomsday. And to tell you the truth, I got absolutely nothing out of the fight emotionally. But I thought the fight where Batman went to go save Clark's mom was infinitely better. Oh, and that's enough for me. But I thought that fight was probably the best fight in the entire movie, because fights like that are very intimate and you get more emotionally invested into them. The thing that they did with the Avengers against the alien invasion at the end of the first one, that was fine because it always cut to different... instead of seeing all of them really fight at once, you saw flashes to them fighting in individual waves, so there was still that intimacy regarding their fights. The fight against Doomsday was just this big CGI spot fest that I just kind of zoned out during. It reminded me of the fight at the end of Iron Man 3 between all the sets of armors and the quote-unquote Mandarin. But I just... anything that you just saw an intimate fight in, that's what I liked the most. Now we can go ahead and talk about the elephant in the room. The thing that a lot of people were really upset with. And that was the fact that during the actual fight between Batman and Superman, Batman beat the absolute ever-loving crap out of Superman, and a lot of people are upset about that. Now, let me go ahead and give you my logic here as to why I personally don't have an issue with it. Other than when Zod's people attacked and Superman had to fight other Kryptonians, this version of Superman has never really had to go fisticuffs with anyone. Because, well, he's Superman and he doesn't have to. Because of the kryptonite gas making him susceptible to... making him human on the same kind of power level as Batman. Batman, who is this experienced martial artist, this experienced fighter, is going to eat Clark's lunch. And that's something that a lot of people have to accept. He didn't try and flat out kill Clark. The Kryptonite put Clark on Batman's level. And guess what? When they're on the same level, this version of Superman is going to lose to Batman in battle armor, because Batman is, you know, one of the ultimate hand-to-hand fighters in the entire DC universe, and Superman is very punchy-kicky. So that ended, actually, the way that I had hoped it was going to end, with Batman even in the odds and beating the crap out of Superman, because that's what would happen if they were both on the same level and just going hand-to-hand. Now, that's something that may change later when Superman comes back. Batman might actually train Superman in how to do a lot of close combat fighting and stuff. But I thought that fight was good. That was another one of those one-on-one kind of intimate fights that... Oh, Martian Manhunter. That I dug a whole lot. I know some people... I could tell that some people in the theater were not happy. Not happy at all that Superman lost, but they did establish in the movie that if this was a flat-out brawl between the two, Superman would win. That was pretty much established. So Batman had to do whatever he could to even the odds, and that is what he did. And Martian Manhunter is having none of it. Holy crap. Look at him being all zen. Some of the stuff I didn't feel needed to be in the film. That whole thing with the bullet. I know they were trying to give the Lois character something to do, because it's Amy Adams, who was an important part of the Man of Steel movie. Lois, to me, is just... Lois is Lois. Superman's love. She's an important plot device. And that's kind of what she is in the movies, is she's just a plot device. She's something that Superman needs to go save. Some way that Superman can actually feel some kind of kinship with the world. Now, I realized early in the movie, before I was sitting there, it's like Martha Wayne and Martha Kent, because they during one particular scene, I don't remember which one, they mentioned Martha's name with an inflection that made me realize, you know, that's probably going to come into play sometime soon. Is the fact that's probably one thing of how they can talk, is Batman and Superman's mothers are both the exact same name. And sure enough, if that didn't happen. Now, I liked the concept of Lex kidnapping Martha Kent and say, hey, if you don't take care of the bat, she's gonna die. She's gonna be a crispy creature. But I think it was weird that Batman is supposed to be the world's greatest detective, a super genius kind of thing. And Superman is supposed to be, at least in the comics that I read back in the day, he's supposed to be generally a intelligent person. He shouldn't be super smart by any stretch of the imagination, because then he becomes too Monty Hall, too powerful. But I really think that, it's kind of a stupid reason for them to fight. And I was actually watching, I was watching Angry Video Game Nerd's review of the movie. He was doing it with Alpha Omega Sin. And he was talking about, I really wish that their conflict wouldn't have just been, he gets kryptonite and Batman and him start fighting at that point. They expected something a little bit different. And I did have, one of the things I was hoping they were going to kind of do, they didn't though, unfortunately, was I read when they relaunched Superman way back in the early 90s, they had a really interesting way of explaining how Batman, when they first meet, how Batman was able to neutralize Superman. And if you have, I don't know if I've ever talked about this, but if you're just watching it for the review, I think you're really going to like it. It would have been a very interesting way to explain them having to team up. Is the fact that Batman's swinging along Gotham. He's searching for someone named Mockingbird, one of his minor villains, who's been doing all these robberies around the city and murders. and he's swinging from his rope along Gotham, and then all of a sudden, like, someone grabs his rope, and he's looking up, he's like, what? And there's Superman, who, as far as he knows, Batman is an outlaw who takes the law into his own hands, and he's taken him to jail. And Batman's like, okay. So he drops the rope, or he lets go of the rope, and Superman's like, oh no, he's gonna fall to his death if I don't. And he looks down, and Batman's completely gone. And it freaks out Superman. And I actually like that very small scene where Batman throws the gas bombs and Superman runs into the middle of it and he's gone. I really dug that. But let's go ahead and get Martian Manhunter out of this, provided he does not cheese me off. There we are. And he's looking around. He's like, wait a minute. I didn't think this man had any superpowers. And Batman's on a building off to the side. And he's like, powers have nothing to do with it. It has to be subtlety, guile, and expert knowledge of the city. Oh, hello there, Bane. And Superman starts heading toward him like, all right, that's a cute trick. But if I get my hands on you, there's no way you're going to be pulling off any kind of disappearing act. And before Superman can grab hold of Batman, he's like, whoa, 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 wait a minute. Before you actually touch me, I think you need to go ahead and use some of that interesting supervision I've heard so much about. And Superman's like, okay, well, I know you're just trying to stall, but it's not going to work. And then he uses his X-ray vision, or one of his visions, on Batman, and he's like, what the? And Batman has this force field over him. And the thing about it is that this is going to be the kind of a version of the Dark Knight Returns Batman, where he's older and a little bit more mercenary with his tactics. I could see Ben Affleck's version of Batman doing this. There's this force field around him, and Batman says, yeah, it's a simple force field that same kind you see in airport metal detectors. And Superman's like, oh, that's cute, but that's going to be pointless if you think that can stop me. And Batman's like, oh no, it's not going to stop you, but I'm going to tell you what it's going to do. I think it was specifically designed to detect alien DNA or an alien presence close, like touching him. And he says, I have a bomb somewhere here in the city. If you touch me and this force field dissipates, it will go off and kill a random person in the city. So it's kind of similar to the incident with Martha Kent, in that forcing Superman to do something, otherwise someone's going to die. And Superman's like, you would kill an innocent person just to stop me? What kind of inhuman monster are you? To which Batman replies, well, I'm just, you know, covering myself. Here, why don't you help me on this case? And Superman ends up helping Batman catch Mockingbird. And Batman kind of teaches him a lesson about different types of villains, because Superman didn't really have to deal with any kind of psychotic villains that Batman dealt with. And at the end of it, after they save the city and Mockingbird is in jail. Oh, you were not beating me with a backbreaker. Well, it is Bane. Batman's like, all right, well, I guess we're going to go our separate ways. You know I'm not a villain. Let me go ahead and continue my private war. To which Superman replies, all right, but there is still an issue of this bomb that's going to kill an innocent person. And Batman's like, oh yeah, my bomb. And he reaches into his utility belt and pulls out a bomb, like a small, like capsule-sized bomb, and tosses it to Superman. He's, here you go. And Batman had the bomb on him the entire time. So I think that kind of would have been an interesting way to do it, especially with this version of Batman. Because this Batman does kill in the movie. I mean, he does. There are people who are not surviving the things that Batman is doing to them. But most of the time, it's always when he has a vehicle. I don't think he killed anyone. Yeah, he didn't kill anyone during the fight in the warehouse trying to save Martha. The only time he killed someone was when it was the Batmobile or the Batwing. It's just Batman, when he's behind the wheel of his toys, he has no cares about people that he has to take down in self-defense. So I think that's kind of what they're going for with that character. If it's hand-to-hand, he will not kill, for the most part, although he was going to kill Superman. But it was an interesting take, I thought. Ooh. Okay, did I get him? Let's get him again. Ah! Crap. Curse you, Bane! Do you think you're being treated unfairly? Oh, that was a Darth Vader quote, wasn't it? Let's see. I am still looking forward to the other movies that are going to come out. And the interest, another plot hole that I kind of want to talk about is the fact that Lex Luthor knows who Superman is. That's the reason that that Martha got kidnapped in the first place. How did he find out, and why didn't he use that information? Because that would definitely harm Superman to let people know his secret identity as Clark Kent, because paparazzi and all this kind of stuff and the kind of world that we live in now, it would be a nightmare for Kal-El to have to deal with that, or deal with his family having to deal with that. So I don't understand, like, why just nothing came out of it, though, unfortunately. But, ow. Well, thanks, Bane. Appreciate that. This is going about as well as it did during the Nightfall storyline. Let's give it one more try, because I do want to fight Superman. I think it's only fair that we go ahead and end this plane on a high note. But I thought about in terms of the fighting aspect, and also they Batman calls him Bruce, so Superman called him Bruce, so Superman knew what Batman's secret identity was, and there's no real follow through on it for everything. That's why I really wish that this would have been two movies, because they had a cover to establish this new world that they're using to compete against Marvel. And I think they put too much in a 2.5 hour movie. This is very similar to, I don't really have a premise for it, but if you had done two movies, no one would have not gone and seen both movies. You know what I mean? Like people would have made do and saw both. Oh, Bane, you being that guy, man, Bane can deal out a lot of damage very quick, especially if he blew his venom. That's what he did. But I think what I would have done, they're playing catch up right now, and a lot of people know that. They're trying to play catch up to the Marvel movies. But I'm just kind of wondering why they feel they need to play catch up when they really just could have waited until this Marvel Phase 2 was over and then came out with their movies. Because I think that at that point, because people would maybe have gotten sick of, well, I don't think they would have got sick of Marvel, but it would have been a perfect opportunity for them to fill that gap after Phase 2 ended. But they want to go straight out to compete against the Marvel films. And I think they got a lot of work that they've got to do before that happens. We saw a cameo by Kevin Costner as Clark's dad, as Jonathan Kent. I noticed that a lot, both characters seem to have delusions, a lot of delusions. You had Bruce having his dreams and whatnot, and then Superman having his visions of his dad. I really don't know where they're kind of going for that. Like when they established the boom tube scene, where I assume it's Flash, owie, comes out and is trying to warn Batman, and then he wakes up like it was a dream. Like, what's the deal there? What's going to be? Was that Dr. Fate? What led that to having Bruce suddenly wake up and think that it was a vision? It just, a lot of it just made no sense to me. Ow! Well, that's about how I expected to go. Gotta even the odds up just a little bit. Thing about it is, in the trailer, that scene where Clark grabs hold, and I apologize for my rambling, but that scene where Clark grabs hold of that gas cylinder that Superman shoots at him, I knew, like, right then, I was like, all right, that's going to blow up into gas, and that's the kryptonite, and that's how he's able to keep up with Superman. But if you guys haven't, if you guys have decided to just watch this video and not care about spoilers, you should watch it. It's definitely going to, it's not a bad movie by any stretch of the imagination. They just put way too much in the pot. They should have strung it out just a bit longer. But it was good. It's definitely, it was worth the price of admission. That's all I ask for in a movie is, please, oh crap. Let's wager. What'd we do? Oh, he healed. Not good. And this is where he ends me. Yep. I remember this boss fight to know what happens. Now, this is evil Superman. This is the Superman that you see during Clark's vision. Going to the thing where he's essentially the heir to Darkseid. And that was the cool thing during that vision, because the world looked very, very similar to Apocalypse, with the huge geysers of flame and all that. So I'm looking forward to what they're going to do next. I think the next movie is Wonder Woman. And another thing that I want to kind of bring up, if they're bringing the Justice League together, where's Green Lantern at? Because Green Lantern was nowhere to be found at all, and you are got me in a corner. What I was expecting is, like, when they nuke the planet, or not they don't nuke the planet, but when they nuke space where Doomsday and Superman are fighting, and Superman's just laying there kind of all shriveled up, I was wondering if all of a sudden you were going to see a green glow, and that was going to be like Green Lantern's introduction, that he saw Superman in orbit and just sent him down. Like, he doesn't want to get really involved in Earth's matters yet, but he's going to help out Superman. Because that was the only member of the League that we have not seen yet. I am so about to lose this round, like, horribly. And that's Lantern. Now, I wonder who, because Flash looked different. Cyborg looked about how I expected him to be. And Aquaman, Jason Momoa as Aquaman, that's what I'm actually looking forward to out of this universe, besides the Batman solo movie. More than anything else is the Aquaman movie, because I think Jason Momoa looks, that version of Aquaman looks awesome. That harkens to my favorite version of the character in the comics and in the animated universe, with the long hair and the hook for the hand. He'll probably lose his hand maybe later in the set of movies, but I think it has a lot of potential to be really, really good. You have to make sure you get the right villain for him, for Aquaman, which I guess would be maybe Ocean Master or Black Manta, something like that. Maybe he'll take on Cthulhu. Stranger things have happened. Some sort of undersea threat that no one's aware of. Because one thing that these guys are going to have to do if they want to compete with Marvel is not be as formulaic as they have been. Because that's just not going to help them out in any way, shape, or form. Now he was in his super, wasn't he? He had his buff up. It did take a fair bit of damage, though. Let's see, maybe I can even the, ow. Just got planet punched. Well, this is about as even as I'm gonna get. Just gotta keep the pressure on. There we go. Good job. Owie! Frozen breath is not, is, frozen breath is worst breath. Here comes the wager. And one thing I'm kind of curious as to, what is going to happen with that kryptonite spear? Like, when it was in the ocean, my first thought was, oh, Aquaman's gonna come up and use it like his trident, but that was not the case. 1, 2, I think we got him. Got him! You go ahead and get sent into the Phantom Zone, sir. Where you belong. It's really good, though, seeing Superman in a movie with multiple meta-human characters and Batman, because that's really where Superman does some of his best work in terms of character. I have to say this. If they are going to do any more standalone Superman movies with Henry Cavill, all I ask is if you do one with him as, you know, near the end, like an older Superman movie, they need to do Superman versus the Elite. If you guys haven't watched that animated movie, look up, I think it might be on Netflix, look up Superman versus the Elite, and I could just imagine Henry Cavill playing the role of Superman in that beautifully. I think that would be absolutely epic. But those are pretty much my thoughts on Batman v Superman. A lot of plot holes, but a lot of fun at the same time. And it's going to be really interesting which directions they're going to go with this and how they're going to bring in this plot with the new movies coming out. It's going to be exciting. This was one thing that disadvantage is the fact that Marvel had all this time to make these movies and establish their universe. DC didn't have that luxury. They went right into the Dark Side, the beginning of the Dark Side storyline. So we get to see that basically their phase one and phase two is right now in these movies. So they're going to have to play a lot of learn via experience what works and what doesn't and what the fans want to see. And they can go ahead and work for that. Hopefully Warner Brothers has enough money in the coffers, and hopefully these movies make money so they're able to implement those changes and make this a really good film series. Let's hope for the best, you know? But I will go ahead and end it here. Hope you guys have enjoyed the review. If you liked it, please leave a like down below. Subscribe to the channel. Leave a comment. That'd be a big help. Tell me what you thought about the movie. And we will see you guys next time. Later days, everyone.